Wrong method. Those in the church are open, right? We're not gonna do it wrong. All right, we got a good lesson today, and I apologize to anybody that didn't bring the Sunday school books for. I will get them, got the box sitting right there, walk right off with them. Such a creature of habit.
I got mine.
Food was great last week, wasn't it? How'd you like that fish last week?
Oh, yeah.
That was a chef that let over.
No, Brother Ron finished it off.
Oh, did he?
Yeah. Brother Ron finished it off.
And Alan.
All right, we're gonna get into Abram Ham. We have progress from Abram. We're now working with Abram Ham. And we're gonna see if we can get some serious questions answered today. Number one, what was the test all about? What was the test all about when God told Abraham to offer up his son? And can you imagine yourself in that day receiving that test from God? Does God, I guess we can ask the question also, does God test us? What does he test us about? Why the test? And let's see here. We're in on this New Testament side. We can rest in some assurances because if you go to Hebrews, the 6th chapter, even though our lesson is in Galatians, the 22nd chapter, verse 1 through verse 14. I mean Genesis, I said Galatians. Genesis 22, chapter, verse 1 through the first 14 verses. Let's take a quick peek in Hebrews, the 6th chapter. Quick peek, Hebrews 6. Six and 13. We want to see also this faith. What does work have to do with faith? Work. God made the promise. Hebrews 6, verse 13. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely I will bless thee, and multiplying, I will multiply. So after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. What was the promise? Well, God made several promises to Abraham. He promised that he'd have a great name, as we studied weeks before in Genesis, the 12th chapter. Great name, be a blessing, and you'll have a great nation. So Hebrews 6:14, surely I would bless thee, multiplying, I will multiply. So after he had patiently endured, he obtained the promise. So the promises did not come in one fell swoop. They came, I would say, increments in God's time that were fulfilled in Abraham's life. Now, what Abraham told God, okay, you made all these promises. That's good. I'm talking like we talked to one another. That's good. But what about, I got a concern. My concern, I have no child, no heir. What are you going to do? What about what's really pertaining to me right now, my address? So God says, you're going to have a child. It's going to be of your own heir. I promise you that. So Abraham had to accept that. How? By faith. Verse 17 of Hebrews 6th chapter, God willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel, confirming it by an oath. So, we have here, let's jump all the way back over into Galatians. I say Galatians. Why am I saying Galatians?
Genesis.
Genesis. Should we be in Galatians today? Galatians on his mind. Genesis 22, 22nd chapter. Let's look at the day that Abraham walked through the land that God told him to leave, go to a country. Look at the environment. It was a pagan environment, pagan country. A pagan country. And God tested Abraham through something that's very familiar with, let's say, bringing in the way that the world does it. That test that God told Abraham to do, it was not nothing that Abraham had never seen or heard of before. The pagans do it. They sacrifice their kids on the altar. I'm walking through the land of the Amorites, and this is what they do. So the methodology of the test was not strange to Abraham. And the object of the test, your kid, was not a strange thing for Abraham to hear of. So, test today, 2012. Non-believers don't pay tithe, trying to get ahead. Don't keep your money. Can all you get, keep all you can. Don't pay tithe. Don't go to church. Don't do all these kind of things. That's nothing new. Everybody's doing. Matter of fact, I would say only two people, three people, four people. Not more than five people on my block, or maybe 20 or 30. Only those four or five of them go to church every Sunday. The rest of them seem to be doing okay. Maybe the four or five of us is on the wrong side of the issue. Maybe I should do it like the world does it. What's so different? What's so the contrast? So God told Abraham, here's the test. Just like the pagans do it, won't you offer up your kid? Just like the world is doing it. You want to get ahead, save some money, get ahead. Do like they do it. Stop paying all that money to the church. Stop spending all of your time at the church. Stop doing it that way and do it like they do. Here's your test. I'm going to bring you through this.
This brother John is recording.
Tell him to stop it.
Yeah, we need to
turn it off.
No, not necessarily turn it off. That's not the final test, though.
Okay.
Do it like your neighbors, like you were saying, your neighbors do it. That's not the final test.
Okay.
In Psalm 73, I believe, the whole book of Psalms tells us the psalmist looked at the same kind of things that you were talking about, and they were prospering and all.
Mm-hmm.
But then he said when he went into the sanctuary,
all right. Mm-hmm.
And then he saw the end of the consequence of all of it, then he knew he was on the right side of
all
the issue.
Right.
Yeah.
And then also like Psalm 37 in reference to just right. Side note, Psalm 37.
Uh-huh.
Side note.
Same thing.
Okay, Genesis, before we get into Genesis 22, look at Genesis 17. Let's hear the promise once again. Genesis 17, verse 15. Concerning this particular issue, the kid. Genesis 17, verse 15. God said unto Abraham, as for Sarah thy wife, thou shalt call her name Sarah, but Sarah should be her name. I will bless her and give thee a son also of her. Yes, I would bless her. She should be a mother of nations. Kings of people should be of her. Abraham fell on his face and did what?
Laugh.
Did what?
Laugh.
Yeah, right. Should a child be born unto him that is what?
100 years old.
And should Sarah that is 90 years old get pregnant? And Abraham said unto God, oh, that who?
Ishmael
might be before thee. God says, Sarah, thy wife, should bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him. What was Isaac's nickname?
What was the meaning of the name?
Laughter. Meaning of the name is laughter.
That's right.
Laughter. because Sarah laughed at the promise. The ability to that to be fulfilled to Sarah was a joke.
Abraham.
it was a joke. Based on what I'm looking at, this is a joke. So that's how they took it. This is a joke. And then God says, come on, man, let's make Ishmael my heir. This is real man. Sarah. So.
One thing that I get out of that, though, that I see there, that even though they thought it was impossible and they laughed at it, they still, right before God said her name shall no longer be Sarai, it should be Sarah, they kept speaking the word even though they didn't believe it. They kept speaking it until they did believe it. So that's what believers need to do now, too.
Yeah, that's right. So we're going to get to the reality that faith is a developing process. Not overnight. Overnight, quickly, you can't believe for some things. Yeah, I take that. I mean, instantly you believe Jesus in your heart as your Lord and Savior, paid the price for your sins. And you said it with your mouth, you believe it in your heart and said it with your mouth. That's instant faith. But there's some things, and some of us get faith instantly from stuff. Oh, we got it covered. Some other things, it's a process that you have to work with to get to the end results. This was one of them. 100 years old and 90, and now we're going to have a kid, and I'm going to be a father of many and have a great nations under me? Well, let's see. So, first of all, take a trip. Take a trip. The trip that Abraham was on, let's look at it, Genesis 22:1. It came to pass after these things that God did tempt. The word says tempt who? Abraham. Tempt. Question for the class. Does God tempt us?
Not to evil.
Huh?
Not to evil. Not to evil.
All right. Question to the class. Does God tempt us?
Yes.
The answer to the question is yes. He does tempt us. The correct answer to the question is not with evil. Don't have that as an instrument. So you don't have evil up there, so he can't tempt you with it. But he will tempt us, test us, to if we are devoted, to see if we are devoted, easier word, committed to what we are believing for. Let that soak in a little bit. Are you devoted to the process of receiving the promise by faith? And along the path from starting to getting there, God would test us to see if we are devoted or committed to the process, the journey of getting there. Whoa. Journey, the test, the trip, the time to get there. Are you sold out to it? That's what he'll tempt you to. Because there ain't no need in us going nowhere if we both ain't on the same page. Ain't no need in us riding the river if we both ain't gonna be in the boat. If I know you gonna jump out as soon as the waves come, ain't no need me bringing you in, you know. Road together, and you say, some of the apostles had this problem. Timothy, I want to go back and see mama. I'm lonely. I'm missing the wife. I thought she was going with me. No, no. Shoot, I didn't know it's going to be this bad. This So, God had to check to see, you still with me? You still with me? And we'll see. So, he doesn't only does he ask the question, he tests you out to see if you still with him. Personal, collectively, however the faith issue, whatever it may be, you have to answer that question. Is that am I still with you? So that's what he did with Abraham. It was only a 3-day trip up to the sacrifice point. 3 days to get there. 50 miles. Genesis 22:8. Look at that real quick.
Part of the lesson?
Mm-hmm. We'll wait. Okay. All right, we already talked that it's 99. We pretty much got the laughter. Does he tempt us or commit it? Let's go to the point 2021. Came to pass after these things, God did tempt Abraham. Said unto him, Abraham, he says, what? Here I am. So what did he say to him? Just want to read verse 2.
And he said, take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains, which I'll tell thee of.
Which I'll point out the mountain to you. Can anybody give me some information on the land Moriah? It's an important place because it's a place of sacrifice. Everybody went there to make the sacrifices. And if you look at 2 Chronicles 3 and 1, that's where the temple was built. The temple was built there. And what do you do within the temple? Is you make sacrifices. So the temple was built Mount in the land of Moriah. It's going to be a certain mountain that you go to up in that area. And all they do there is offer sacrifices. And also along the way, Abraham, on your journey, you'll see the unbelievers, the pagans, doing the same thing all the time. That's what they do. They make sacrificial offerings to the pagan gods, to their kids. If you devoted to the God of the sun, and it's time for you to offer up your son, or your kid, or your child, that's what you do. And that was nothing new for Abraham. So if you receive, if you get a temptation that tempts you to do what unbelievers are doing, parallel with what the way that they do stuff, you know, I know it's going to kind of shake us up a little bit. Wow. God, you said what? So God said, check out this temptation, this test I'm putting you through. So let's see. Verse 6.
And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife. And they went both of them together.
Amen. So God says, oh, come to church Sunday. And you say, okay, got my suit, dressed like Brother Beauty, nice necklace and all that good stuff. Shoppers can be. Travis gets decked out every now and then. Curtis too. On my way. Do they have everything they need to really go to church? Are they taking everything that's needed to make it make it really worthwhile being in church today? They got all this needed to be in the house. Did they bring everything?
No.
What do I need to bring, Sister Hill? She should really be able to answer this.
They need their sword.
Okay, all right. You need your Bible?
Oh, there you go.
Need your Bible? All right. What else? See, God said, Abraham, come get up here and be ready to worship and make a sacrifice. So when you leave your house on Sunday morning, you're on your way. What you got to take?
And you need to have a good attitude, a willingness to receive the word.
Give me some tangible stuff.
Okay. Your Bible and tangible stuff?
Okay, that's one.
Okay.
Hey!
Offering. That was kind of low. I didn't hear it.
bring your word, bring some money. Anybody else? Those are two important things you definitely gotta have.
Okay. Bring some, the intangibles, huh?
Okay. So tangible. Bring the word and bring some money.
Bring your booklets to take notes.
Bring something to take a note. That's right, buddy. Write something down.
Bring your faith.
Tangible. I want some stuff I'm gonna see you carry. Something I can see. Visible. My brother's ready for church. Got his Bible, got his wallet, got his notebook. She got her purse. Got the checkbook in the purse. ready to make an impact at this place when they get here. Mm-hmm. They call that sacrifice. Mm-hmm. So here's what, so God, so Abraham was going up there, what did he take? He took the wood.
Knife.
Okay.
And his son.
Okay. And the son. And the offering. And they went both of them together. That's how you go to church. Some folks say, come as you are. Hold up. Yeah, that's the easy way. Come as you are. Hold up. No, no, no. Bring the good stuff. Bring the stuff with you. So that's a note. Cost y'all a quarter each for that. Maybe a donut on Monday and a cup of coffee. So they went both of them up together. So they brought the stuff to make the sacrifice. All right, so without the stuff, if they went up there without that, God says, yeah, you ain't rich. They not serious. They not serious. Where's the knife? He got to cut his throat. Where's the sharp knife? Where's the wood to set him on fire? Right? The stuff. Which, all right. On the way up to the mountain, there's not a word spoken. It's not shown in the scripture. There was a conversation from the start up into the mountain. It's not a big conversation going on. How many of us sit down with a client, your first date? It's so important, but ain't nobody saying anything. Somebody got to break the ice. You ever been there? You know. Break the ice. Get on the elevator with a stranger, and you know, somebody ought to say something. When you see each other, why don't you say it? Speak. Nobody, don't talk. Somebody has to what? Break the ice. Oh, you know, you get them boots. Oh, I just thought I asked. You know, so you can get a conversation going. But here, no, very little talking. First person to talk. First person to talk. Isaac breaks the ice. Serious stuff going on right here, Isaac and Jacob. So he says what? And Isaac spoke up. Isaac spoke up and said, what?
Oh, yeah. Father.
Mm-hmm. And he said what?
Here I am.
Here
I am, son.
Boy, I wouldn't have known that. He's so quiet. Everybody, have you ever been in a room with somebody and you say, even in the car, I wouldn't have known that if she spoke up. So serious business. He says, here I am. Oh, my God. I know you. Here I am. I'm here. That's what he said. I'm here. My son. And he said, look, the fire and the wood. Fire and the wood. There's serious stuff going on here. Dad, you ain't saying much. I gotta break the ice. Here I am. Why would have known that unless she spoke up? He says, Abraham said, the way that Abraham said this, this is what he is saying. God is looking. Mm-hmm. God is looking. God is seeing. So you put it in your personal life today, you're going through some stuff, you and your spouse, y'all both know, maybe even talking a lot about it, you just realize that we got a test on us. Wow, it's heavy. We both feel it. We don't even talk a lot about it. But the leader has to say, the mature one has to say, my grandma used to say this all the time, God sees.
That's right. Your grandma was right.
She was right. I was just a little bit, but she'd be saying that. God sees. Grandma, so-and-so is. Daddy got drunk last night. God sees. Catching me as a little child off balance. What? Even as bad as all this is going on, God sees. For a little child, that's enough to comfort you. Oh. Don't have to answer you, but she said, God sees. Somebody says, God knows. Some people say it like that. God sees. Oh. So, finish that. Someone read that if you would, please. Let's read that verse 8, all of it.
Verse 8?
Uh-huh.
And Abraham said,
"My son, God will provide himself a lamb for our burnt offering."
So they went and bore him together.
God sees what we're doing, and he knows what's needed. And they came to the place which God had told them of. All right, what happened there?
And Abraham built an altar there, and laid the wood in order, and bound Isaac his son, and laid him on the altar on the wood.
All right. We have to say that Isaac had a great deal of trust in Abraham. As a kid, he had a great deal of trust in his earthly father. How did that come about for you to be so quiet, lead me up here, and bless me, and I ain't kicking and screaming? I'm not kicking and screaming. I'm not no dummy either. How did Isaac develop such trust in his earthly father? I mean, to trust your old man to do this. Russian roulette with my son.
I would.
Will you trust your dad?
I would. My dad's dead, but I would have.
Yeah, I
absolutely
trust mine.
I wouldn't have trusted mine.
I would have trusted.
Oh, Dad, I didn't mean all. I forgot what it's all on YouTube. But I mean, come on, I ain't trusting you playing Russian roulette with me.
They trust
mine. Well, if you take the trouble to build up due to him spending time with it, you know, from the time he was born up until whatever age he was at the time, you know, Abraham probably spent every day sitting there talking to him, explaining stuff.
Okay.
Just
well, she trusted her. Kayla said she trusted her.
Yeah.
What made you trust your dad? If he said, get up, go to church, did that make you get up, go to church? Or did they send you to church?
No. Yeah, we all went together.
All right. So
and there was no discussion in our house as to whether you're going or not.
Okay.
I mean, it was almost a given from kids up. We all went together.
So you pretty much developed the trust that this is the thing to be doing.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
But
no question.
My old man, I don't know about yours, Brother Williams, if he told me to get up and go to church, which he did, but you know what? He was under the covers on the pillow.
See, the trust is developed by Brother Williams. You teach children by precept and example.
How long?
You just can't tell them what to do. You got to be an example.
So Isaac had observed his dad.
Yeah.
That's where the trust comes from. He observed, not because he knows so much and all
right.
Like that. Mm-hmm. No, I'm watching.
Right.
And when Abraham said, God sees, Isaac says, I see too. Mm-hmm. I've been seeing too. Since I've been watching you. You're my earthly father. I've been watching you. And you said that the heavenly father sees. So everything's cool. It's the only thing that settled the whole issue.
But mm-hmm. Well, there's another component too. Isaac knew that this was a pagan nation,
mm-hmm.
and he knew that children were sacrificed.
Yes, sir.
So, I mean, if the scripture doesn't tell us what he thought,
mm-hmm.
but even if it were in his mind that I'm going to be sacrificed, mm-hmm. I mean, it didn't say anything that he spoke against it or whatever. He just went on.
That's right.
Because he knew that was a practice.
Yeah, he says, I've been watching my dad, mm-hmm. and he's been following the invisible God,
mm-hmm.
and he's told me that God sees what he's doing. I'm comfortable with that. There's some things that your parents probably told you did not understand.
Right, definitely.
Didn't even agree with.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, even as a kid, you know, sometimes when our parents tell us to do the right thing, right, the right thing wasn't always the easy thing, but we saw that them doing the right thing, we always came out okay.
Yeah, always came out okay. Yeah, God seeing, so it must be, I don't understand. I don't necessarily really agree, but here we go. I got you. Dad's got it. I got you. Now, if it's contrary in there and, you know, things don't match up on the same page, kid ain't following.
Absolutely.
That's just the way it goes. But Isaac said Abraham was a good dad to that kid, and he saw Abraham growing up in the ways of the invisible God, and Isaac said, it's okay. I've been seeing Dad, God been seeing Dad, everything's okay. Because Abraham has been walking in obedience. From Isaac's birth, Isaac's been saying, my dad's been obeying God, the invisible God. That's the only way it works. We're still in a serious test here. Are you devoted to the outcome? Are you devoted to the process of faith? Now, God says, Abraham, I want to see that you are devoted to, committed to this process that I told you.
Do you think during that time, when Isaac, after he put him on the altar, you know, even though he did, he tied him up and bound him, you know, laid him up there. But before, on the way up there, Abraham had told Isaac, he said, God will provide a ram.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so Isaac landed up on the deal. He said, okay, my daddy always said God don't provide, and God has always provided.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe, you know, this is just the point to where I have to go to before God's death in. You know, his faith came into play that he knew that God wasn't going to let his dad sacrifice him.
I think,
it doesn't say that, but do you think?
I believe that Isaac was committed to get my throat cut.
You think so?
Yeah,
because he knew that other children had
been sacrificed. This is what I've been.
But now I have a question. Do you think Abraham knew that God was going to do what he did?
Up until the angel, which I believe it was the Lord telling him to stop, I believe Abraham was saying, I'm going to cut your throat. I'm going to cut your throat.
I think Abraham believed the promise.
Okay, let's go back to a scripture we read earlier.
Okay.
Now it's Genesis 17 and 19.
Okay.
And that one, I think, will tell us this part, the last part. He said, everybody there? Yeah. 17, 19. Mm-hmm. I will, 17 and 19. I will establish my covenant with him, meaning Isaac.
It says 17 and 19?
Yes.
Okay.
Chapter 17.
Chapter 17, Genesis, in verse 19.
Okay.
The last part.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Let me start here. And thou shalt call his name Isaac. Mm-hmm. And I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant.
Yeah.
And with his seed after him.
Yeah.
He said, I'm going to establish my covenant with him.
Yeah.
So Abraham then had some assurance that that boy wasn't going to die. Because he made a promise back then. He said, I'm going to establish my covenant with him.
All right. Let's go to
with
did
him.
Did he believe that he wasn't going to die? Or did he believe that even
he could die, he would raise him up.
Back.
Yeah. Either way.
Yeah, that's what I was getting to. I believe it was in Hebrews 11 somewhere.
That he would raise him up.
Yeah, he says, even, what was it?
11:17.
Hebrews 11:17.
He knew that
11:17.
That the promise was going to come through Isaac.
He knew that. He had believed that the promise had come through Isaac, but he didn't know if he had to kill Isaac or not.
Oh, he's 17 to 19.
Hebrews 11, 17. Okay, go ahead.
By 11 faith, what?
11, 17.
Okay.
By faith, Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promise offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said, that in Isaac shall thy seed be called.
Yes.
Accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure.
In a figure, okay. So Abraham was pretty much committed to cutting the cubes. Mm-hmm. Even God would have to raise him up.
Because God, he was committed to doing whatever because God, had given his order to him.
Yeah. He was committed to obeying what God told him.
He was committed to obeying.
Yeah.
But that verse in 17 Genesis let us know.
Yeah, that the promise is coming through him.
Right.
Now, I don't
that
know how if I cut his throat, I don't know how God's going to do
but
this.
But he's going to do it.
But he's going to do it. But I'm committed to obeying God to cut his throat. Now, that's what God is testing us today. How committed are you to the process of seeing this thing through the end? Because if I tell you to do something, will you do it, and will you look back on the promise that I made to you concerning this thing that concerns you? God, I can't